Hi everyone, we want to welcome you all today to join us for today's presentation. My name is Cassie and I work for the ALS Association Oregon and Southwest Washington chapter. And today's presentation is one of four that we are focusing on this week to bring to all of you the latest in science, clinical research, and future ALS treatments. Today's presentation will focus on providing updates on the latest in clinical research trials. We'd like to first just take a moment. To thank our sponsors for today's event, Ability Center, Fortis Construction, New Motion, Providence Brain and Spine Institute, The Standard, and VC Fund. Just a few housekeeping items to keep in mind. Today's webinar will approximately last 1 hour, which will include time for questions. All participants' video and microphones are disabled to reduce interruption. And we highly encourage asking questions for Dr. Nick Olney, who is our presenter this afternoon. You may do that by inputting your questions in the Q&A down at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And lastly, today's presentation will be recorded and made available for later viewing. And today's presentation is also being streamed live over Facebook for those who were unable to register. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Nicholas Olney. Dr. Olney is the co-director of the Providence ALS Center in Portland. Dr. Olney received his medical degree at the University of California, San Francisco, and completed his neurology residency at the University of California, Los Angeles. Residency, Dr. Olney returned to UCSF to focus on neurodegenerative disease and research prior to joining the Providence ALS team. Dr. Olney has a unique perspective into his work with ALS patients, having been a primary caregiver for his own father who lived with ALS. I'm so honored to have you here with us today, Dr. Olney. Thank you so much for joining us. I'll stop sharing my screen now and we can get your presentation on up.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for the introduction, Cassie. Let me see. So I just shared my screen, right? Okay. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay. All right. So it's like automatically going. All right. So thank you very much for the invitation to speak today. My name is Nick Olney again, and actually recently director of the ALS Center. I'm gonna talk to you about clinical trials. I think there's some very exciting things going on. And I don't actually know exactly what this picture's from, but I think it's a sci-fi thing. And I think it's just kind of these people reaching, and I just think we're really close. So I think that's what I kind of do that. I don't exactly know where that's from, but just to tell you a little bit about myself, again, Cassie told you, but I was born up here in Portland and then moved down to the Bay Area, second grade. And then I did my undergrad at UCSD. And after graduating, I worked in biotech for a while. And that's unfortunately when my dad was affected with motor neuron disease or ALS. So I moved home to become a caregiver. Here's a picture from me back then when I was a caregiver. And kind of learned firsthand how devastating this disease is. And I think in talking with my dad, he was also a doctor, and I think it really inspired me to want to try to be on the team that will find an effective treatment and or cure. So basically then I got into medical school, was lucky and got into UCSF and I could still be around my family. I did my first ALS research in pseudobulbar affect, which is the uncontrolled laughing and crying that can happen in ALS. And my dad actually had that as well. And then I went to basically did my medicine year in Oakland. Then I did 3 years of general neurology at UCLA, then 3 years of fellowship at UCSF on research. I also got an ALS research fellowship focusing on spinal cord imaging. At that point, actually, my ALS mentor, Dr. Lohmannhirth, knew heard Dr. Goslin was planning on retiring and had a very active clinical trial center. And so that's how I actually interviewed at Providence, and it was a great match. And I think also to attest to that was, many of you probably know Lance, but Lance was one of the first people I interviewed, and I recognized his name because he was one that actually delivered equipment to our cabin that we go to at Black Butte every year when we vacation in Central Oregon. So I think that was a start to a great match. So it's been really great to be here and to talk about clinical trials. So I'm excited to share this information with you guys. I do have to go over some of my disclosures. So as I mentioned, I did do my first research in pseudobulbar affect. And so at one point, Avanir, the company that puts out Nudexta, asked me to share my research there, and they invited me to become a part of the visiting expert program. And I also am a PI and co-PI for the clinical trials here at Providence. I'm trying to present this in an unbiased way, and I'm not presenting any of the proprietary information. All this stuff is found open source on the internet or through PubMed or through posters and presentations at the national or international talks that I go to. So I'll just briefly go about how we think about these trials. Just going to start at one, and I'm going to do a very simplistic way, but just how we think about it. I think you can see my mouse here. So phase one trials are usually really the first time in humans, so they're usually a bit higher risk, and it's probably about 20 to 50 people. Phase two is really then when it's, well, traditionally it was typically different dosages. So pretty much everyone got the drug, and it'd be multiple dosages. And then phase three are the ones that people are very commonly hearing about, that it is the basically where people get often 2-to-1. So two people get the drug and one people don't. And that's what's something required by our FDA to prove that they work. Now people are getting creative and making phase two and three trials. And we'll get into that a little bit later, but those are the very traditional way and brief way of just 1 minute explaining clinical trials. And actually just, this is a slide from ALSA, and these, all these are trials supported by ALSA throughout the year. So a lot of clinical trials. I really have no time to cover all of them. I'm really just trying to cover highlights of I think exciting stories that I'm following. So first I'm gonna actually cover a couple of the trials that have been active in my center. And they're all at a little bit different phases, so I'll go through that. So, but just stories I'm certainly following. So this is arimoclomol, actually pretty much was fully enrolled in 2019. And hopefully by the end of 2020, things will be totally wrapped up, and we might actually get some results hopefully in early 2021. This basically had a, I like that this is a, had a mechanism targeted basically trial, and that it's supposed to increase heat shock protein to remove these protein aggregates we believe are bad in ALS. And the trial was designed to measure prolonging survival with this drug. Include 230 patients, US and Europe. It actually filled quite fast. And it's actually headed by Michael Benatar as a main scientific advisor, and he worked in some exciting kind of biomarker secondary endpoints. And this is by Orphazyme. So certainly a study I'm excited to see what the results are. Another study that we just have participated in and actually fully enrolled just a month ago is TAME. This is Dr. Barone is the head of this one. Also Todd Levine had helped with some of this data, but this is therapy in ALS with memantine. So memantine's already been approved for dementia. So actually this one had some very early data in mice, as well as a very small study of 20 patients suggesting the combination of Ralutek and memantine may prolong survival. So because this was already FDA approved, it was able to jump some of those steps and just go straight to testing it in 90 humans because a lot of the safety data had already been sorted out. So this one, again, just enrolled. So it's probably gonna be a year or more till we actually probably get some answers from this study. And then the last study, at least just a more traditional model, is Abutilast. Actually, head scientific advisor Bjorn Oskarsson, a great guy, seen at a lot of the conferences. Also, he's part of the Western ALS Consortium that we're a part of. So is Dr. Barone, and actually Dr. Benatar is part of, heads the CREATE Consortium, which we just recently joined. But Abutilast is an exciting compound. It already is FDA approved in Japan. For other indications, so thought to be quite safe, but it's basically thought to be a macrophage migratory inhibitory factor inhibitor, as well as a phosphodiesterase inhibitor. It's really kind of an inflammatory, anti-inflammatory type medication. It's pretty early on. It is looked at other kinds of disease groups, but it's enrolling in patients in less than 18 months. And Medica Nova here is the sponsor, and this information is taken from the International ALS Abstract they presented in 2019. So, going back again, these are all different phases. So the arimoclomol enrolled, we're actually hoping that the trial wraps up and has results pretty soon. The TAME just enrolled, so it'll probably take about a year. And this one actively enrolling, so it'll take a while to enroll, and then these go on for about a year, and then hopefully get the results from there. So I think some other exciting things, though, again, going back to this model of phase 1, 2, 3, is how can we make some of these models more efficient or get answers even quicker? I mean, that's actually a major question for me and the ALS patients that I take care of. So I'd like to present the Healy platform trial. So again, some of these traditional models, not that they're bad, but how they've traditionally been done is you build a stadium, you run the race of this one drug, and then once you have the results, you take it down. And then if the next trial comes up, you need to build another stadium. So the platform trial works is that we're trying to build one stadium with multiple races going on at the same time, races or trials. And then also hopefully if these trials are actually interchangeable. So if say one had side effects, you could take one out. You could also, if one is effective, keep it going. And you don't have to keep recreating all the infrastructure it takes to get these trials going. So to show this again in another way, sort of multiple kind of regimens going on. I think that is one challenge of the trial is that people do have to be okay randomizing. So if you really researched one, you don't get guaranteed that you're in that one regiment. But then once you're randomized to regiment, it's then randomized to active treatment or placebo. And the placebo here are shared. So it's more of a 3-to-5 ratio rather than a 2-to-3 ratio of actually getting active drug. And they have a lot of high powered statisticians working on this and show that this can cut costs by 3 as well as cut time in half. So to show that a little bit more, again here, what I think is exciting is how this basically pools the placebo as well as, I think the other part that's interesting about this too is that a lot of traditional trials are about 12 months before they go open label. Here it's 6 months. Also, patients are allowed to enroll up to 3 years of symptoms. A lot of the other trials are often wanting people more than about 12 to 24 months of symptoms. Here's a bit more of the, again, how this is powered and some of the statistics behind it. So if 10 therapies are tested, this is just some stats that they put out, and it's designed to detect something that's 30% or better at slowing the disease process down. So here it cuts down the amount of participants, cuts down the amount of placebos. It does include many more patients who are interested in trials. Also, if any of these therapies are successful, can by at least 30%, we'll shave this down to 4 years to get answers. It sounds like a very good model. And this has been done again in other fields in hematology, but not in the world of neurology. So these are some of the compounds, basically from Ra Pharma, this complement C5 inhibitor, Biohaven with a myeloperoxidase inhibitor, and the Clean Nanomedicine with the gold nanocrystals. And then hopefully by 2021, we're able to add in some of these other platforms. So even having more races in this stadium of the Healy platform trial. Probably not gonna go too much farther into these medications or treatments because I know Sabrina is gonna be giving a talk later and go much farther into this. But they are measuring traditional endpoints. And this is also just to add to the other trials. Most trials are using the ALS functional rating scale. Also secondary endpoints of respiratory function, muscle strength, usually with hand dynamometry, looking at survival. And then there is also specific biomarkers if applicable. They also have some exciting exploratory endpoints. So what I like about the Healy trial is that assuming patients consent for this, there are ways to bank your DNA with the Harvard system, also looking at special biomarkers and other kind of experimental things they're looking to roll into clinical trials. So this is not opened yet, but I think we'll likely be opening soon. Providence is a selected site, and we're just kind of working on setting up that stadium to start running the races. So other things that I think are also exciting coming up is ALS genetic therapies. I mean, these have been in the labs for decades, and finally getting to the point where we're able to see how they work for actual therapies. So to recap, genetic ALS, probably only about 10% of ALS is thought to be genetic. And then to recap, the two biggest genes are SOD1, which is 2% of overall ALS, and then C9 of familial, probably about 55%, although C9 also has been reported as high as 20 to 30% of sporadic ALS. But I'm gonna be focusing primarily on SOD1 because this is where we've had most of the initial data and mouse models that we will, that we've based a lot of ALS research, and that's where these genetic therapies have been targeted first. So as a possible mechanism for SOD1, someone has this gene and it is thought to be a toxic gain of function is the most accepted theory. And basically these proteins are made in the nucleus and then they're misfolded and they have multiple ways that they could probably be affecting cellular machinery and causing neuron death. So to recap some basic theories of biology here, where this is targeting is the RNA. So the DNA is in the cell, and when the cell wants to make a protein, it will transcribe RNA. The RNA then goes into the cytoplasm, and then it will be joining this machinery that will then produce a protein. And so if you have a toxic gene like SOD1, a way to prevent this protein from happening is to actually bind up the RNA in the cytoplasm before the protein is even made. So it's really trying to get this at the as early as possible. And then this was actually one of my early, in a way, mentor, Tim Miller, who was very excited and very involved in this research. And I actually met him and shadowed him at UCSD when I did my undergraduate. And he had just finished, I think, a lot of his training and was starting to go back into the basic science and learn some of this from Don Cleveland in his lab, who's a very big basic science researcher. So there's many people involved in all of these drugs, but I'm just kind of highlighting at least a lot of the people I personally know and often interact with at these conferences that I go to. This is basically a similar story, again, of how the mechanism of these antisense oligonucleotides are proposed to work. So the medication that's currently in clinical trials is tofersen. It's an SOD1 ASO or antisense oligonucleotide. The study is Valor phase 3, and they're recruiting both slow and rapid progressors. And again, this is basically a genetic treatment targeting the mRNA of people that have the gene of SOD1 to block the toxic protein. So this study is ongoing, so there's only some limited clinical data out, but I would go to one of the posters that Dr. Miller presented in one of the NEALS or AAN 2019. And this was 50 patients getting an ascending dose, so increasing dosages of the medication, and some people getting placebo. They did this at different time points here. And this is one of the graphs that basically blue is placebo, so people that did not get the drug, and orange is the people that got the highest level of drug. And this is measuring the protein in the spinal fluid at different days of getting these treatments. And what it's showing is actually the amount of the SOD1 protein is going down as the drugs go up and as the more doses they are getting. So I think this is just showing that we're having some target engagement here. So I think this is exciting. Also, clinically, again, showing the ALS functional rating scale. So blue would be people not getting drug and orange would be getting drug. And so here we are seeing, unfortunately, continued progression in people not getting the drug. And then people that did get the drug, there is some stabilization here in the orange. Also, the slow vital capacity. So breathing numbers, again. The blue, people not getting the drug, showing that there is the continued expected decline. And then there's some stabilization here that was significant when people did get the drug. And this was, again, the higher dose of the drug. The other thing that's exciting as well that Biogen's working on is wrapping up a phase 1 C9ORF72 antisense oligonucleotide. So again, a limited amount of people actually getting this right now, but if it passes safety, I think it likely will expand to go nationwide and will hopefully come to the Northwest. And what I think also is exciting about this is that I did mention that you do have to have the gene of the C9ORF72, but there are some sporadic ALS cases that do have C9ORF72. And so this might be a potential treatment and reason we should be screening patients more for C9ORF72. Challenging to get covered by insurance though, unfortunately. So, and then one of the other trials that I think is also quite exciting, this did not come to the Northwest, but is the Brainstorm or Neurone trial. So I get tons of questions about this in my clinic. They have a very good website, which I put up here. And a lot of this is actually just taken from their website, but I've seen similar data presented at national, international conferences in the last couple of years. So this study has been fully enrolled. So we're pretty much waiting for data, but just so you get a little background on, again, what this trial is, we'll get into that today. So there's multiple ways that these stem cells could work. One would be that it helps with giving growth factors to nerves that we think are good. One would be also to help get rid of, again, kind of exosomes, mRNA, to kind of get rid of toxins or things we think are bad for the cells, as well as also turn down neuroinflammation, which we all think. So all these three mechanisms we think could be related to the progression of motor neuron disease, and this could potentially target all three of them. So this is, basically this does involve a procedure where they actually harvest bone marrow. They then send it to the lab and do a proprietary way of making these safe aliquots. And then they have to do multiple lumbar punctures to give the drug. And they really aren't expecting these cells to integrate into the cells. They're really expecting this as kind of a delivery way of delivering these growth factors and all these things, these three mechanisms they think that could be supportive for the central nervous system and the motor neurons. So out of Mayo, Dr. Staff, you might be looking at it and saying this looks kind of like an invasive procedure, but Dr. Staff did this with 27 patients at Mayo, and this is one of the first studies showing that it actually was quite safe, and they even did it up to 10 times the two different dosages with 10 times the amount in different dosages, and it was quite tolerated with no major adverse side effects, which is good. So we want to do that before we start doing a big trial. And then this is again from the company website. So again, looking at the growth factors. So to set this up, the ones on the right here, these are each different growth factors. The ones on the right are the placebo and getting placebo injections, so no therapeutic stem cells. And then the patients on the left are ones getting before and after. So the white is before and the blue is after. So really you can see in all of the groups that got the stem cells, these growth factors are going up. So that's one way of measuring that. Cytokines level, again, would be a way of turning down inflammation. So again, placebo on the right, two different kinds of cytokines associated with inflammation. And again, if white is the general inflammation beforehand, then afterwards it goes down. So supporting that theory well, that this is an active target. Then increasing mRNA. So again, this is a way to help eliminate toxins. So again, on the right is placebo. On the left is basically people getting the treatment and two different kinds of mRNAs and basically having these levels increase, which we think would help eliminate toxins or things we don't want in the cells and hopefully help improve survival. So I think this is some very exciting data that there's some target engagement that these stem cells are doing something, but we do want to see how this actually affects patients clinically. Besides just being able to measure things in the spinal fluid. So this came out in JAMA Neurology in 2016. It's a small group of patients, only 14 patients, but it compared 3 months of prior getting one injection and 6 months after getting a treatment. And they did show the functional rating scale, again, just 14 patients though, going from 1.2 to 0.6. And the breathing also got somewhat stabilized as well, or slowed progression. So I'll show just the graphs. I'd actually probably point you to more to the intrathecal, since this is the ways that was actually injected into the spinal fluid. This was an intramuscular that didn't show as much change. But in the intrathecal, just to walk you through this graph, this is the functional rating scale. The line here is when they got injection. This is the 3 months prior to injection. And then after is tracking the functional rating scale. And you do see actually some stability. And this would be the prediction of continued progression. And then they show similarly too in the phase 2A group. So you know, this is limited data presenting from the initial 26, then 48 patients in 2010, 2014. So the neuron trial was 200 patients, again, fully enrolled. And I know me and many patients are eagerly awaiting these results to see, because there's so many mechanisms this could potentially work. But did not come to the Northwest, so we're waiting for these results, and hopefully we will have those by the first part of 2021. So I had to give a disclaimer that I can't cover all clinical trials, but I think also it's exciting that in looking at clinicaltrials.gov, if you type in ALS study, there's 810 studies active in America enrolling, 146 actively recruiting. And when I gave this talk a few months ago, this has actually already gone up, I think about 10 or 20 in each of those areas. So quite exciting. So then I think going back to this picture here, I want to thank you again for your attendance, but I think that we are actually quite close and to a major breakthrough, that many of these basic science things are just finally coming to actual trials. And I think it's a very exciting time to be in clinical trials and quite hopeful. So that's actually the end of my talk. So I know I'm done a little early, but hopefully that gives us some time to have some extra questions. Thank you again so much also for inviting me, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Olney. We really appreciate you taking the time today. That was a lot of really interesting information. So we do have a couple of questions from folks who have been listening in today. So would you kind of walk us through how some of these potential treatments go from the lab bench kind of into the trial process?
Sure, yeah. So that's some of what I was trying to highlight with the phase 1, 2, and 3. So as I mentioned, I guess for instance, Dr. Miller, you know, they had SOD1 mice they were looking at for probably a decade and trying to figure out what's the right target. How do we get this into the mice? So they have to do a whole lot of different kind of safety animal data before we can even think about putting it in humans. I mean, it has to pass a whole lot of safety guidelines first. And then it needs FDA approval, it needs regulation. And then that's when you do start the phase 1, which is often the first 20 to 50 patients that might get an actual active drug. So those people are very heavily monitored. I mean, some of these are even people that might even be admitted to a hospital or a special research unit to see to make sure there aren't any side effects to these drugs. So there's a whole lot of R&D. I mean, I'm actually presenting all this of other people's data and a lot of, there's, again, years of basic science, whole teams and mini labs, all in these areas. I just print some kind of poster people of who gives a lot of the talks at the clinical talks at the national conferences.
And kind of a follow-up to that, how do the pharma companies decide kind of what to bring to trial as kind of the next step?
Yeah, good question. And I guess one thing just to add to that other one, I mean, it often does start, sometimes people just start with an animal model, but sometimes it starts from cells, and sometimes there's genetics. I mean, there's a whole lot of very multifactorial basic science techniques, but you generally need it to have it work in an animal model to even think it would work in kind of a human model. So there are usually many years of data that you need before that. So how do pharmaceutical companies choose? So I'm actually, again, more on the other side of the clinical side and not there. I mean, my job is to review to make sure all the safety data looks good before I want to present these trials and experiments to my patients. But I did actually work in pharmaceuticals, and I was doing very large lab screens. So, I mean, they have a very, very much of a shotgun approach, again, in these animals for figuring out what's safe and what's not safe. And I think they really are trying to choose what's the best target. And so a lot of it, safety is certainly high on their list, as well as they usually want to have some basic science supporting kind of target engagement. And so I think that's very exciting about some of the data I showed with especially the neuron. I mean, some of actually the trials I mentioned in my study, there is some basic science data. I just didn't present it all, but those are really exciting things. And also some of the drugs, the Healy platform trial, I mean, they actually are choosing some studies that are more drugs that are phase 2, but they want something that has some target engagement. So something you could measure in the blood that it's changing something, that it is actually doing something measured, in the, what we call the biospecimens, at the same time. So I think if you have a safe drug that looks like that's mechanism based and looks like there's some target engagement, I think that's a very exciting compound for a drug company to move forward on. And I think you see that. I mean, I think you see that now that, I mean, when my dad was sick, there's not nearly as many clinical trials. And now there's like 800 studies in the US and 140 recruiting. I mean, we're getting a lot of the national studies up here, but some other places like big centers like Mayo might have these little tiny phase one trials and things going on. So.
Yeah. And it all adds up. Yeah.
It all adds up. Because if one of those really takes off, if there's really a huge signal, and again, those 20 to 50 patients in the phase one or a phase two, then you can even more quickly move through these things, these phases.
Dr. Olney, I think we might have lost your audio.
Can you hear me now? Should I log back on?
Yeah, I think we're good. Sorry, go ahead.
Okay. Did that answer the question? I don't know if when it cut out.
Yeah, I think we're good. There's been a couple other questions that have been asked. Question about L-serine in phase two study, or just any updates in L-serine in general?
Sure, good question. I think that one's still pretty, I haven't seen any recent studies on it lately. So I probably would have to stick to more of the trials I do am more familiar with, but I'd be happy to try to look at that and get back to you more online. So I know it has been a kind of more of a supplement on trials. And I know one of the big places, I guess, to add to that, I mean, one of the first places when I don't know the answers, the first place I usually go is to ALSuntangled.com. I think is a great place for what are supplements or things that might be in trials. And I know that Dr. Bedlack out of Duke is one of the ones that runs that site and is actively trying to get some trials similar to like the L-serine or even curcumin started. I mean, I think those things are exciting. I think, you know, there's not a lot of times a pharmaceutical company behind them. So I think you just want to make sure they're kind of rational trial designs there. And I will say also some of these studies too, if you actually look, so I don't know, each of my trials that I enroll in, you know, some of these things like curcumin, because there is a trial planned for it, you actually aren't allowed to be in a trial with a pharmaceutical company. So that is one other thing to think about with that. But I think I always have a pretty broad approach when I talk about options with patients. I always want to talk about first FDA approved treatments, what we know, what we don't know. And then I always approach supplements and the trials as things that, you know, they still are kind of experiments.
Great. So a couple of questions about access right now. Curious about how COVID has impacted ability to do ALS research studies. And then I think a kind of a second question to that also is, for folks who are outside of the centers that get involved in research, how can they get involved?
Yeah, so wait, Sarah, say the second question again.
So as we, of course, partner and work with ALS Certified Treatment Centers of Excellence, for those treatment centers that are not offering research access, how can folks who are, say, within the Kaiser system or down in Southern Oregon get involved in some of the clinical trials?
Yeah, so I guess to answer the first question, how has COVID affected trials? I mean, I think definitely in those first couple months, March, April, things did kind of slow down. We never actually fully shut down because we have people taking experimental drugs that need monitoring. So we never slowed that down. We did slow down opening up some new trials. I will say that TAME trial I mentioned with Dr. Barone heading, I mean, that trial actually very quickly adapted to going as virtual as possible. And I think that's one of the reasons they got filled so quickly. And there wasn't a lot of other trials opening. A lot of people wanted to wait and see a little bit, see what happened with coronavirus. But I think things are getting back on track. I mean, I think things are sustainably open. I think one of the challenges with ALS research drugs is that they do want to always be measuring the pulmonary tests. And I think this is just a nationwide problem that we know that those pulmonary tests in clinic blow droplets. So now we have to do them in negative pressure rooms or figure out other workarounds. So I think that's something that's adding I have to account for, and things we were trying to always find workarounds. And me and all the different groups and consortiums I'm on are talking about that too. But I don't think it's really slowing down at this point. I mean, I think it's really pretty much open, and we know this is important. And I think that we're continuing to do that. And then the other question you had about how do people get into trials? So certainly, you know, we take referrals from all centers. Now, I think part of the challenge with this too is, if say someone has a long commute, I think that is something that we have to balance, because if you're in an experimental trial, you do need some level of monitoring to make sure you don't get any kind of side effects. So I think a lot of the world of clinical trials is trying to maybe minimize that amount. So some can be virtual and some can be in person, but there is a certain amount of level of lab monitoring and things that has to happen. So I think you approach each of these as a case by case, and each trial that opens is they are, some of them are moving to more virtual, at least part-time checkpoints. But I would say in general, things used to require 1 month checkups. I think some people now maybe push that to 2 or 3, but there's usually not that people can't never be regulated again. So, or monitored in person. So.
Great. Thank you. And kind of along those same lines, in terms of just eligibility for some of these clinical trials, what suggestions or recommendations might you have for people who are not newly diagnosed, who are maybe further along in the disease process, but want to be involved in research? What might you say to those folks?
Yeah, and that was actually a huge topic in our national meeting at the NEALS meeting this year about open access. And I think those are things that are certainly more in discussion. I do think that actually like the Healy platform trial and the TAME trial is one of the first few studies, actually allowing up to 36 months of symptoms. So they are pushing that and knowing that's a real thing. I think if people have more than the 36 months of symptoms though, then I think it is looking at FDA approved treatments, or there always are some ways of, of looking at, I think also that's where some of the kind of supplements or other things like that can play in. A lot of these also, the parameters of eligibility can change. I mean, sometimes it's actually, someone might have symptoms for 3 years, but the criteria might be based on 1 year from diagnosis. So it doesn't actually say, but that's always a challenge. And I'm always trying to get, I mean, I look at one of my job is trying to go to these national, international conferences to kind of network to bring some of these things to give my patients options. But I don't think it's for everyone, but I want to make sure my patients who want to be on these treatments can do it. And I can also say at least one other thing that I have heard Dr. Bedlack talking some about, maybe thinking about some trials of, and there's so many questions about supplements and things, and we're all kind of working on, is there ways to include a broader group of patients? So.
Yeah. That's great. Thank you. I know we're getting a little bit close to time, but just a few more questions that have come in. So question from a Kaiser patient, for a clinical trial, how can other folks from other centers get involved through Providence?
Yeah, and it cut out a second, but it's on, this is a patient from Kaiser asking about how to get into clinical trials. Yeah, so we actually have a webpage and I have a clinical trials coordinator, and they basically ask for records and we screen all the cases and we try to tell people what they're eligible for by even pre-screening to make sure, again, if we have patients coming from far away, that they will at least preemptively know if they qualify or don't qualify even prior to record review. So we do a lot of record review, and we do, I mean, when we have a trial open, we do let the network of other ALS providers know that these are open and that people can be referred to them if they want to. And so then, and then usually again, after the records review, we are, I usually do establish a longer visit with me, just reviewing all the records, doing a very thorough exam, and then going over the actual pros and cons of the clinical trial. I mean, a lot of the risks and benefits of the trial. So,
yeah, great. And I'd say, you know, for anybody who's watching, who's interested in clinical research, you know, feel free to reach out to the ALS Association in addition to your neurologist. We've got some information we can definitely share and make sure you're on listservs to get some of those research updates on what's happening locally. So a quick question about Neurone. This person says, what's kind of general thought? We're waiting on results. What's general thought on the timeline when that might become available and open for others if the results are positive? Of course, crystal ball, but.
Yeah. I mean, hard question because I'm not involved in that study. I think we're waiting for that group of 200 for what's the clinical outcome. I mean, the basic science data looks good, but we want to see what the clinical translation is. I probably would have to go off of, what's going on, what happened with Radicava, that once Radicava was approved, I mean, we were able to get, I think it was approved around in June, and probably by even the fall, we were able to get it to people. So I mean, that's maybe a little bit simpler because it's a IV med rather than having to do this kind of bone marrow biopsy and proprietary thing in the lab and making designated aliquots. So I don't know how much that would delay things, but I do know companies are trying to plan to move very quick. And I can say the other one, I mean, I didn't talk at all about Amylyx. Imagine Sabrina might talk about that in her talk, but I mean, that one's certainly seeking FDA approval really. And I support that just to give patient access to it. So people don't have to be paying a lot of money for an off-label use. And again, even now, since it's not FDA approved, would disqualify you from any other experimental trial. At least so far that I've seen. So I think that, I certainly support that. And I like these ideas of, I talked about the traditional model because it's easier to talk about for the phase 1, 2, 3, but I like these early ideas just because you could shave off a lot of years of development in these. That is to trade off with risk, but I think that that's an exciting way to go because I know that time is of the essence, so.
Yeah. And you mentioned Sabrina's talk. So Dr. Paganoni will be giving a talk on Thursday. She's going to be focusing quite a bit on trial and some of the really exciting results that just came out for AMX0035, as well as talking more about the Healy platform trial. So thank you so much for bringing that up and kind of going through it. So in the spirit of time and allowing you to eat some lunch and go back to your normal daily schedule, just thought we'd end by just asking what kind of gives you hope in terms of ALS research. You know, you shared a lot of information today, but kind of what personally makes you feel like we're really close?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just a very exciting time to be in clinical trials, and that I think there's just so much interest in by all the biotech companies. And that, I mean, I think that, again, I think Amylyx got it a positive study. That's exciting. And I think that we're getting more and more compounds. And I'm hoping, I guess I talk about this in at some of the conferences with the friends when I'm hobnobbing with people. But, you know, I really hope we're maybe like in the early phase of kind of like the HIV time where maybe one drug did something, but it wasn't until you put a combination of all these together. So if we can get more and more positive studies, I think then we can start doing these combination trials and really have, I think, a good shot at an effective treatment/cure. So I think, and I really like, again, how the Healy platform's, trying to get something that's over 30%, and that's what we want. And we want something as that slows the process down as much as possible, if not even does more than that. So. But I think hopeful time just for how much interest, and you can even see, I mean, the amount of studies are growing. Patients always are so great to work with. And to, I think people are, as you mentioned, patients even that are beyond the requirement are always trying to participate in research. And so that's, I think, something we're very blessed with, so.
Well, we are honored to have you on, on the ALS team and supporting people in walking through all of these often very confusing requirements for clinical trials and research world. So thank you for all that you do. And thanks for taking the time to talk with us all today. And for those who are interested, tomorrow we will be hosting another research talk with Dr. Kuldeep Dave, who is the VP for research with the National ALS Association team. And we'll be back here at noon tomorrow. So everybody for tuning in, and thank you again, Dr. Olney.
All right. Thank you. Thanks for all the questions as well. Thanks, Elsa. Thanks, Cassie.
Bye.
All right.